all the lights, sweet darling. But before we do that, we need Mrs. A to come up here because our 50-50 is worth $1,600. So the winner gets picked $583. So you get to pick. It's too legit to quit. Some of you 2,000 babies. So pull out your tickets, everyone.
Of the poem Prendimiento de Antonita el Cambrio, he shut the classroom door. I remember feeling then, as I do even now when I pick up Lorca, who was murdered in secret by Franco's thugs at the height of Spain's fascism for being an outlier, a critic for his difference. that I was handling something furtive, precious, and potent. As young Antonito appeared dark as the green moon in the Spanish language verses Mrs. Anchocytus delicately teased out for us, walking the byways of Sevilla jauntily and slow, gabroso, we felt the ache of his youth, the precarity of his life, the urge to see and speak and transit somewhere wholly different from our experience. For generations of high school kids growing up in Schenectady and its commutable environs, Mrs. Anchocytus offered us portals like these, a specter or a duende, that revealed to us that no matter whether we traveled actually or intellectually or spiritually, there were so many places we might go. Tonight, our musical extravaganza celebrates Melanie Anchocytus' long involvement with the Notre Dame Bishop Gibbons musicals, but we would be remiss if we did not also take this opportunity to celebrate her career as a lifelong educator, a tireless advocate for young people, and a capacious role model for our community. You've heard of the musical interlude, and now I would like to welcome you to the talking interlude. In the fall of 1970, Melanie arrived at Notre Dame High School in Schenectady at the clear-eyed age of 21. She had gotten a gig as a Spanish teacher the previous spring on her way home to Buffalo from graduation at St. Lawrence University. Melanie's parents waited in the car as she interviewed. She was offered the job on the spot. In 1975, after 4 years on the faculty and without much warning, the diocese merged Notre Dame with the boys' school down the way. Melanie was among the first wave of women educators in what had previously been a predominantly masculine space. The Christian Brothers had to receive contentious permission from the order to even teach girls. Navigating the facility change, the rocky novelty of co-ed classes, and a feeling of latent disenfranchisement from the young women and a handful of rehired teachers that had been dispossessed of their beloved institution was no easy task. The challenges were both curricular and cultural. Melanie carries not only the mantle of that original feminized faculty, but also her baby shower was the first ever celebrated in this building. So for everyone who thought her eldest, Kevin Anchocytus, was just another pretty paleoclimatologist, you know now that he's secretly a harbinger of barrier-busting educational equity. Teaching hiatus dedicated to her beloved family, Kevin, Jeff, and Gibbons fan favorite, Mr. A. Melanie returned to this institution full-time in 1989 and never left. She educated hundreds, probably thousands of students, elevated programs in Spanish language curriculum, creating first Spanish 4, then 5. She directed, let me say this one more time, 21 musicals. Set up a mentoring program first at Brown Elementary School and now at St. Catherine. Oversaw after-prom parties, ran the father-daughter dance, co-coached the state-winning mock trial team, and ran 12 trips to Spain. Even now, I understand that she's retired and the chair of the Spanish department. You all know that's not how retirement works, right? Mrs. A's reputation is for her gentle but insistent affection, for speaking to each student passes through her doorway. How's it going? Nice barrette. Loved that essay. My co-host Adam told me that he always thinks of the way Mrs. A signs her emails, con cariño, literally with care. Or as alumna Emily Brown put it, Mrs. A showed me how far kindness goes. Everybody is carrying something, Melanie told me recently. Kids carry a lot, and their shoulders are much smaller. To be in Spanish class with Mrs. Anchocytus was always an invitation and a possibility. Christine Basile told me that when she was a student, instead of Mrs. A scolding a group of teenage girls to get rid of their fruity lip glosses at the beginning of each class, she would simply invite them to review their gloss flavors, but in Spanish. Instead of memorizing rote vocabulary, we built cities on our classroom walls to learn the world words for places we could be, We looked at paintings of the Spanish masters, not for the quiz, but so that we'd recognize the ghostly, elongated limbs of El Greco's Christ at the Prado, or the skyline of Segovia if we were lucky enough to slip within sight of the Roman aqueduct. We studied Spanish fables, not to answer essay questions about them, but so that we could write our own cuentos adentro cuentos, nesting doll-styled stories. Instead of writing research papers on distant Latin American cities, we would pick a place and plan our would-be trip in the company of our friends, what sights we could see, what restaurants we would dine at, how we would spend time that was always already our own. Mrs. A's greatest strength as an educator is not how much sheer power and knowledge she wields, though she does. Rather, it's how ready she is to gift that power away. And it's a power that was never bound to the classroom anyway. I spoke to a handful of former students in preparation for this evening, and each said without a doubt that it was Mrs. A's vivid stories of walking through the Alhambra, of politely trying to eat an apple with a fork and a butter knife, of beholding Picasso's brushstrokes at the base of his massive painting, Guernica, of flicking bugs whimsically off her mosquito net, that had lit their own passion for travel first in her meticulously organized experiential learning trips to Spain, then in university study abroad programs, and finally in the rest of their lives. Travel wasn't always glamorous or an adventure, but to experience faraway places Mrs. A showed us was to expand our depth, our understanding, our sense of wonder, and quite frankly, our humanity. She also taught us about friendship. Thinking of her many tireless collaborations with so many colleagues, including Colleen Radinsky, Bernadette Vaccaro, Paul O'Brien, Tom McQuire, and of course, her most frequent and beloved co-conspirator, her hermana, Linda Neidel. Mrs. A modeled to us the possibilities of adult friendship, of working in unison instead of in competition, the importance of seeking out people who constantly pushed you, appreciated you, counseled you, challenged you, and consoled you. The Neidel-Anshokaitis Alliance is still my gold standard for female friendship. Two women who are as smart as they are styly, as kind as they can just be a little bit scary, in all the best ways. Melanie has asked me to highlight the community that has always permeated Notre Dame Bishop Gibbons. It nurtured her, she said, and provided a nest where she could be creative and give back. This place, she says, is family. Many of the people who have passed through our school, students, teachers, and staff, have left their imprint on her heart. Mrs. A, on behalf of all of us upon whom you bestowed that imprint in return, whose whole lives you changed one kind word at a time, let me say congratulations, Senora, and buena hora, and thank you.
Tonight, Taylor Jarvis will step in the role just because Mrs. A loves the song. Finally, Kim Hockey reprises her 2002 role as Bloody Mary, singing Valley High, a haunting song designed to entice U.S. Marine Lieutenant Cable to the island. I was a sophomore that year, and in my first role ever, I played Lieutenant Cable. Mr. McGuire, in his own special way, informed me that I would have to kiss my love interest, Leah, Bloody Mary's daughter, played by Brittany Crowley, in front of her then-boyfriend, who was also in the cast. When I objected, Mr. McGuire replied, "Tough shit!" This was also, of course, the year that Sam Dyckman had us all in stitches as he appeared as Lieutenant Billis, sporting his very fashionable coconut bra. Without further ado or trips down memory lane, Teresa Tokarowski playing Nellie Forbush, singing "I'm in Love with a Wonderful Guy." Say earlier she made an oops. I'll take this one. It is my pleasure to reintroduce somebody who maybe wasn't heard all the way in the back the last time that she came out to sing. It is my pleasure to reintroduce Kim Hockey singing once again for all of us, "Wouldn't It Be Loverly."
Setting music. How about that Adam Weatherwax? And how about this microphone? I'm enjoying myself right now. This one's from Mrs. A.
Takes good care of me.
like to present Senator Paul Tonko, Congressman Paul Tonko, who is here to make a proclamation in honor of Mrs. Melanie Anchitaitis.
Thank you, Vicki. Thank you, Vicki Baldwin and Greg Sorrentino, for your leadership with the board. Thank you to all of the faculty and staff, leadership at NDBG, for the awesome experience of quality education, and to join with the Friends of Notre Dame Bishop Gibbons as a support network that continues to allow for the mission of education to be embraced here at this wonderful institution. And it's been said that education is the drawing forth of the soul of the individual and allowing for self-discovery in the classroom or on the stage or through other extracurricular activities that enable our students to prosper from the value added of education. And so tonight, it's an honor to join with all of you as you pay tribute to the mission statement of this school, the great accomplishments, the legacy of this great mission of education, and to recognize as an honoree this evening, Mrs. A, who, as a leader in the arts community here, enabled students to discover what greatness lies within them, that drawing forth of the soul can happen on the stage, and the effervescence that it builds into the school experience, the ability to work as a team and offer a production, the ability to know about your individual talents and skills, to reach deep and express them, has all been encouraged and nurtured by Melanie Anchitaitis, who is tonight's person of fame that we say thank you to. And Melanie, it's my honor to offer a citation, a certificate of recognition to you for your great service to this wonderful school community, and to encourage you to continue to inspire those who I'm sure are very much impacted by your love and devotion as an awesome person of this education team. So congratulations and thank you so much. And look at the stars.
A person in nails. Daisy and May, a cliche coming true. I'm romantic and bright like a moon, starry night, pouring light on the tomb.
my heart she came, only to fly away, only to fly as day flies from moonlight. Now I'm alone, still dreaming of paradise, still saying that paradise wants me, really wants mine.
Most people live on a lonely island, lost in the middle of a foggy sea. Most people long for another island, one where they know your own special hopes, your own special dreams bloom on the hillside and shine in the streams. If you try, you'll find me where the sky meets the sea.
Someday you'll find me swimming through the sunshine, my head sticking out from a low flying cloud. You'll hear me call you, singing through the sunshine, sweet and clear as can.
In 2006, our MDVG stage was transformed into an Inquisition-era dungeon for Man of La Mancha, one of Melanie's favorite shows, adapted by Dale Wasserman from Cervantes's 17th century classic. The role of Don Quixote was so memorably played by Jonathan Wood, and Quixote's faithful sidekick, Sancho Panza, was played by Sam Dykeman. Sam's sister Erin and classmate Liz Allers comically embraced the roles of Quixote and Panza's horses. A very young Celeste Hudson had the female lead as Aldonza Dulcinea. In 2016, we unexpectedly lost our beloved Jonathan, whose mom Connie has continued to support every show since John came to us in 2003 and is in the audience tonight. Remembering Jonathan, Kyle Dykeman, Taylor Jarvis, Sean, and Stephen Baldwin will lend their voices to The Impossible Dream.
Brings the house down.
Music by Jerry Bach and lyrics by Sheldon Harnick, Fiddler on the Roof is the age-old story of the tension between tradition and change. Set in an early 20th century Ukrainian Jewish village, Fiddler, the story of a humble dairyman, Tevye, trying to settle the futures of his five daughters who, one by one, reject the customs of arranged marriage for a love match. Tonight, we present three songs from that show, bringing together five members of the 2012 cast. All five will join voices in Sunrise, Sunset, a parent's reflection on the swiftness of childhood. Next, Taylor Jarvis will reprise his role as Perchik, the Marxist revolutionary who has fallen in love with Tevye's second daughter, Hoddle, to sing, "Now I Have Everything." Finally, Stephen Baldwin will reprise his role as Tevye, singing the iconic, "If I Were a Rich Man."
So tall.
Was it in his
but that was only half true. I had a name in life, and that was everything, but now I even have you. I have something that I could die for, someone that I can live for too. I have everything, not only everything, I have a little bit more. Besides having everything, I know what everything's for. I used to wonder, could there be a why to share such a difficult, wandering kind of life?
Thank you.
Irving Berlin's classic White Christmas was the first show that Mrs. A directed after Mr. McGuire's death, and remains one of her all-time favorites, which NDVG produced again in 2014. In 2009, a tiny Rebecca Sforzella played the orphaned granddaughter Susan. When we decided to redo the show only 5 years later, it was in large part because we had two more adorable and talented little sixth grade girls we wanted to find a vehicle for. In the stage version, young Susan has an expanded role and sings. The show offers strong parts for balance of both males and females, a factor not easy to find as we looked for a show to meet the many talented kids we needed to showcase. Tonight we have Sean Baldwin, Tara Strikeman, and Abby Jones. Sean was Bob Wallace, the Bing Crosby character, and Abby played Martha, the housekeeper, Gal Friday to the general, who owns the inn where the story is set. Martha is a former vaudeville star whose past is secreted behind her housework until Wallace and company bring their show to Vermont to aid their beloved World War II leader. Interesting trivia fact, Victoria Chicadance had the distinct opportunity of being in both productions, being in the ensemble in 2009 and playing Martha in 2014. Sean will join Tara Strikeman, one of the 2014 double cast Betty Haynes, role shared with Kelsey Roberts, in the beautiful Count Your Blessings, followed by Abby reprising her wonderful Let Me Sing. Tara will sing Betty's torchy Love You Didn't Do Right By Me.
Ah, this brings back a lot of good memories. You know, we used to have rehearsals that would last even later than this thing does. I mean, I've gotten older, so I can't stay up this late anymore, but the good news is I have two things. A raging insomniac and incredibly paranoid. So this is a song about what you do when you're worried and you can't sleep.
Just
just count your blessings instead of sheep. And you'll fall asleep, counting your blessings. Here's what I do. I think about a nursery and I picture curly heads. And one by one I count them as they slumber in their beds.
If you're worried and you can't sleep,
just count your blessings instead of sheep, and you'll fall asleep, counting your
Sharks, the Swanee Shore, and Mother Farm.
Our show will end as we opened with an ensemble number, Blue Skies, a Berlin classic not included in the famous movie version of White Christmas.
This song is from the show within the show that the characters are staging, thus ending our show on notes of optimism and joy, so fitting to our celebration of Mrs. A's legacy to musical theater at NDBG. Many thanks to our performers and the behind-the-scenes folks who worked so hard to put this show together.
Thank you all for coming and supporting our community, and of course, thank you.
Mil gracias.
To Mrs. A. If Mrs. A could join us on stage.